And since 2015, he joined university, and he will give a talk, which has a very long title, on orchestrating information governance workloads as a stateful service using Kubernetes Operator Frameworks. Cataldo?
Yeah.
It's not working.
No, I'm trying to get this. Yeah, thank you for the introduction, and thank you also for having me here. I'm honored to have one of the 9 presentation or papers that made it to this event. So again, a lot of experience that I have acquired, and what I wanted to do now in the end of my career, so to pass on this in experience, knowledge, and experience. So that's really what I'm trying to do. And the topic of information governance is something I was doing for the last 4 or 5 years, especially with IBM customer in the finance industry. So what I want to talk today is a little bit to introduce you the pain, the problem that this information governance customer have, and then see how can we exploit what we learned so far over the years, and coming from the Hilbert space going into the cloud. So this is the path I want to draw with my speech. So Kubernetes is one thing that I would like to just present you a little bit to introduce you know, what this is all about and how it can help as a tool coming from Google in order to get where we want to go. And then I want to show you a few results that we did on implementing you know, a traditional information governance solution and moving it into the cloud using Kubernetes as the orchestration tool for a complex system. So what is information governance? This is really just brief. I'm doing this several years now, and people really don't want to do it, but they have to do it. So information governance is forcing companies to complement their business requirements with compliance requirements. This means this is a cost factor that they have to you know, get into and to you know, pay for it. And that's something they really want to offload as much as possible, if possible. Now, an IG solution is typically stateful by definition, and it's also quite complex, not as complex as the application or the problems we've seen so far, but it's still a complex application. So in order to amortize and to get rid of the cost factor, or to reduce the cost factor, basically a few years ago, we got this in the finance industry at least, you know, we got this run to the cloud. And I was involved in several of these migration tasks, like customer like Deutsche Bank or Bank of New York Mellon, where we really worked for years in order to get them from a traditional system into a cloud-based and automated system. So what is a cloud solution? Cloud basically is something that people think you know, will reduce the cost because of a scale factor, and a different model of doing business. So it's really not investing money, but just paying for what you use without investing any capital and avoiding any maintenance costs from a customer's perspective. What does it give you? It gives you a scalability, so you can scale as you grow, and it gives you also reliability of your application. This means high availability and disaster recovery built in into the infrastructure. And so cost effectiveness from a provider perspective comes because the provider is exploiting a massive multi-tenancy, so a lot of tenants running on the same infrastructure. And the elasticity of the infrastructure, you know, to provision and deprovision on demand based on loads. But this requires process automation, and process automation means you have to transfer operator knowledge and experience from humans to algorithms, basically. And so the idea is, how do we get there? And the idea is, the solution is automating the orchestration. And one tool of doing so is the operator pattern. Let's look at IG solutions, a blueprint. Typically, it's nothing sophisticated. So you have a layer to access, you know, the services. Typically, a portal that you have there. On the side, on the left-hand side, you have data somewhere in the wild, and this data is connected to some software that basically looks for the data, collects it, does a pre-classification, and then assesses the data and puts it into some kind of a repository, an enterprise repository, where the data then is post-processed, analyzed, and you know, worked on. Now, from a governance point of view, you have to look at you know, implementing control the facilities in order to store information about how the data was processed, who did access it, and you know, work with the data. If there is any kind of audience coming in, or if you have a litigation case or so, you need this information to be in place in order to survive the audience. So from an implementation model, this is typically how the whole software stack is deployed on bare metal. So basically, you have at every layer something like, so the user coming in, you have a load balancer, it distributes over HTTP server. There is another load balancer, it distributes over the client application. Then you have some business logic operating at the application tier. Then typically you have a database, another load balancer here, and then you have the storage here with you know, the physical storage and the facilities of moving data in and out as required. So all this stuff is very intensive. You need people that know what they do, how to implement you know, the cluster, the logic to manage the cluster in order to run the whole facility. And so, but for every layer, you have domain expertise, you have people that are coming in, you know, the database administrators, then you have the application administrators, and you know, overall, then you end up also with people that need to know how to set up basically a high availability secondary server or secondary infrastructure, plus another side for disaster recovery. So you have a quite complex infrastructure, and you have quite complex and a lot of costs in order to entertain all this, just to be available to provide this service at any time, basically, at scale, especially if you have the customer worldwide, for example, right? So what is then the actual pain point? So every cluster has a tier, every tier has a cluster, actually. Then every tier has a specific management and operations requirements for that. And then you have application logic that knows what a cluster is from an application perspective. Does anybody know WebSphere for, here? Does anybody work with WebSphere? A lot of complications there, you know, to get it up and running. And so, and then you have also site reliability engineering and engineers coming in to talk about, you know, how to set up this whole infrastructure. So the challenge is then, how do you get there? And so Google had exactly the same problem, and they came out around 2015 with something called Kubernetes, and meant as a container orchestrator. So this was given then to the Cloud Native Computing Foundation and its ecosystem. And at the time that Google thought about it, you know, Kubernetes was really just for stateless applications. So the idea was, you have something running, if it fails, just create a replica or clone it and rerun it. So that's the model, the easy model of getting you know, an infrastructure as reliable as possible just by replicating you know, the device where, or the component that is failing. Now the operator pattern merged because people were saying there are stateful applications, and it's much more difficult to run stateful applications, and therefore CoreOS came out. Was acquired later by Red Hat and came out with something that is, you know, we need to automate the orchestration, and so they brought in an implementation of the operator pattern. And this is now pushed by Red Hat and IBM now, where they published basically the operator pattern as an SDK around 2018. So coming with my background, I said, okay, let's try this out. I was curious to see whether we could then really migrate what we did before by hand. Typically, this was a work of a team of four or five people for several years to get, you know, an operation up and running with that complexity, you know. So the production system, the high availability system, and then a site, you know, the for cover for sites or disaster recovery. So what we did is then basically we looked into it, and here is a little excerpt on what a operator pattern is all about. So basically, the operator pattern captures this concept of there are humans that know how to do this, so how can we encode their knowledge and experience in something? And they came up with this concept of a custom resource and a custom resource management description. So what to do with that application or cluster application in the context of Kubernetes. And so you have the custom resource itself, then you have the custom resource description. It's a declarative way of saying what the resource looks like and what the infrastructure would look like in where the resource is running. And you have a controller. Controller is basically something that is looking after you know, what are the states of the application, the solution, and if they deviate from what was declared, it will try to bring it up to and reconcile the state, bring it up to the same state as before. And so basically these are then the pieces that you need in order to create such, and I will just skip over this and explain a little bit later the details. So what we did is basically we came from a physical implementation of the infrastructure and the solution and moved it over to basically the cloud-based application, the equivalent basically infrastructure that we had on bare metal. The idea and the profit that we gained is basically that a lot of custom logic on how to basically get the manage the web tier and the application tier, we realized these were stateless applications, so we could move it over and have Kubernetes and the infrastructure manage it without ourselves doing all this. So it really just reusing what was in there. The database tier as a stateful application was much more complicated, and therefore we needed to do something about the database and the storage. So what we did is basically took what was there, deployed there in on bare metal, and added basically the controller necessary to manage everything. So some remained with Kubernetes and built in. We just declared to Kubernetes what to do, the Kubernetes controller for the stateless tiers, and then we added the controller required for the stateful applications or components that we had there. And basically then defined how this would be and how the system would react in order to compensate for a deviation from the defined state. This is an outline of what we did. So this year was pretty easy to implement. It took two master theses to get the students to do this. They componentized the monolithic application basically, and then put it on virtual, and then from virtual into containers. But then this part was still left out, and this is what we then did last year and implemented it using the IBM DB2 database. So this is the normal structure, as you would have you know, a four instance cluster of DB2 cluster on bare metal, but now managed through something that Kubernetes, through the Kubernetes APIs and an extension to the Kubernetes controller logic that is built in there. So this is coming from us, and this is coming from the database or from the product itself. So there is several things that you know, you take and other that you have to wrap to, and then integration points that that need some coding and some logic, the operator logic and the experience of the operator. So this is then basically an outline of the of what we did. So the operator now is nothing else than just a container. The container is being created with some application logic on how to, so you have a description of the DB2 cluster. The application logic looks at the description and implements what's necessary, lookups, compares state information, and does then communicate with the external entities that help doing this. So these are the four DB2 instances, container as well, deployed on different nodes. And then we have another, not shown here, we have another cluster of the basically a key value store where we keep information, configuration information that are looked up by all components. So like the governor here is something we coded in the container themselves, you know, adding to the logic that DB2 itself has, the HADR is the DB2 logic to check, you know, am I the primary, am I the secondary, and so on. So then, using that, we started doing some verification tests. All we wanted to do is not to really test any performance or anything like that. We just wanted to see whether the concept works. Here again, just the DB2 cluster again. So here the governor on every pod that Kubernetes pod that we have that might be on different nodes. This is the external etcd cluster that is basically keeping the configuration and where the current state is also updated by whoever is, you know, the primary or the secondary. And we added two auxiliary databases as well in order to see if we can do a read scalability scale-out model or a scale-out test. So here is an example of a high availability scenario. You start up the whole, you start up the operator basically, then the operator creates the different pods, and the primary is coming up. It sees there is nobody else in here, and then it starts as the primary, then the secondary comes up, sees the primary is there, and then we have auxiliary as well, which are shown up here. So then there is an event, and we took then the primary down. This means the stateful set control loop, this is Kubernetes itself, is checking whether this guy is running or not at a pod level, not application level. So Kubernetes does not know anything about the database. And so it sees this, the primary pod is gone, and then it will create a new pod. Now the primary or the X primary is coming up, but will not be primary because the governor loop here, this is the extension of the Kubernetes control loop, will check whether the primary is up or running. And this is the check going after the key value store here in this cluster. It sees, okay, the primary is no longer responding over a certain point of a certain period of time, and then it will talk to the secondary saying, take over here, the secondary becomes now the new primary. And then this guy says, okay, I'm seeing there is already a primary, I just will become the secondary. And then everyone else checking the etcd, again, the configuration and the auxiliary, the two auxiliary systems will see, okay, there is a new secondary, so they will switch and then contact the new primary, you know, for synchronizing the database. So that's basically the, you know, some of the experience we got and knowledge we put in, and we added also what came with the product in order to have this test scenario up and running. And we did some tests. Again, these numbers are just indicative. It's not about performance, but you can see that Kubernetes itself is quite responsive in checking what's going on. Failover time depends on how you set it, so that you know, the system is checking the key value store, whether the timestamp of the last update is over a certain period of time or not. And so this determines, you know, the failover time, and then you have then the whole failover and service recovery, the service recovery after a certain period of time. We did measure also a little bit of some read performance, but the interest was really to see If the read performance remains stable over, you know, adding 1, 2, 3, or 4 instances. And then we did also look at, you know, how are the the read requests coming from 10 clients, 4 times 10, no, 3 times 10, and each of which was issuing 1,000 read requests. And then we measured basically the distribution of the read requests over the three pods. So again, that's just indicative. It's not really measuring any performance with that respect. So what are our conclusion or a summary? Yes, Kubernetes seems to work quite good. Stateful services, though, require substantial domain and application-specific knowledge, so nothing comes for free. Eat your own cooking doesn't work here. At least you have to go to the experts and get some expert knowledge. Otherwise, it takes ages to get up and running in here. And then if you migrate legacy solution, just get rid of old stuff that doesn't work the normal way and put in cloud native. Even changing database would be a good idea. That's all I wanted to present. Thank you for your attention.
So thank you very much, Cataldo. If one hand rises up very quickly, again, the same game as we had before, but it doesn't seem like it. So, then I will take the time to introduce our last speaker of today, which is Boris Selak. Selak, do you speak it like this?